Like so many independent studios, Arkane Studios was built by gamers who wanted to create the kind of games they enjoyed playing. What makes Arkane's story unique is the kind of games that inspired them, groundbreaking 90s classics known as immersive sims. But Arkane isn't a nostalgia factory. For more than 20 years, Arkane has worked tirelessly, often against overwhelming odds, to keep the timeless principles of the immersive sim philosophy alive and growing into the future. Arkane's founder, Rafael Colantonio, was a lifelong gamer, but his start in the industry was a happy accident. In 1993, EA held a contest to find superfans who were qualified to test Ultima 8, and Colantonio entered just for fun. But it wasn't just a trivia contest. In 2012, Colantonio explained to Polygon, quote, "They called me back, and they said that you haven't won the trip because that was a fake way to find somebody to work for us." Colantonio became EA France's eighth employee, setting up their IT and customer support teams. But by 1997, EA had shifted away from origin-style PC RPGs to focus on sports games for console. Colantonio wasn't interested, so he went to Infogrames. At Infogrames, he managed a small team and produced the Smurfs for the PS1, but that wasn't his calling either. So, in 1999, Colantonio recruited a team of four and launched Arkane Studios in Lyon, France. His dream? To create games in the immersive sim space. Games inspired by Looking Glass Studios' classics like Thief, System Shock, and Ultima Underworld. In fact, Colantonio wanted Arkane's first game to be a sequel to Underworld. His ambitions were blessed by one of the game's co-creators, but Arkane couldn't secure the rights. Arkane was undeterred. Instead, Arkane created Arx Vitalis, an action RPG rooted in immersive sim philosophy. This meant maximizing player choice and opportunities for emerging gameplay. By 2002, Colantonio's passion project had all but emptied the company's coffers. They secured a last-minute deal with the publisher that promptly folded, then found a more stable partner in Joe Wood Productions. Although the game was well-reviewed and earned several nominations for RPG of the Year, Arx Vitalis foundered at retail. History now regards Arx Vitalis as important work, but publishers now saw the IP as a risky bet. This put Arkane in a difficult position. Todd Vaughn at Bethesda Softworks was interested in Arkane's work on Arx Vitalis 2, while Ubisoft wanted to turn that same raw material into the next Might and Magic game. With Arkane just, quote, a few weeks away from going under, Colantonio had a decision to make. Quote, "I could not wait anymore," he told NoClip. Ubisoft made the first offer, so Arx Vitalis 2 became Dark Messiah of Might and Magic. Dark Messiah favored first-person combat over the RPG elements featured in Arx Vitalis, but it was filled with opportunities for immersive action, including spike traps, bottomless pits, falling weights, treacherous ice, and more. Reviews for Dark Messiah ran the gamut from sub 7 to 9+, but time has brought perspective. In 2017, PC Gamer described Dark Messiah as, quote, "a milestone in the growth of one of the industry's most exceptional studios." It would take Arkane 6 years to launch their next IP. 6 years marked by a series of work-for-hire projects and three heartbreaking near misses. Quote, "those three projects come with a lot of nostalgia and a lot of pain," Colantonio recalled. Nevertheless, these three canceled projects helped shape Arkane's philosophy and future in important ways. In 2005, Arkane was tapped by Valve to work on new Half-Life content, known as Return to Ravenholm. The team had inherited work from a canceled project by Junction Point, but were given free rein to build from scratch. Ravenholm would have expanded the Half-Life universe and introduced new mechanics, like a magnet gun and an electroconductive nail gun. It also would have incorporated Arkane's signature immersive sim philosophy. Arkane poured its heart into Ravenholm, but Valve eventually shelved the project. Colantonio attributes the cancellation to business. The game needed, quote, "another year and maybe at least the same amount of money." Art director Sebastian Maton describes Ravenholm as a learning experience. Quote, "everything we learned in Ravenholm, we still use in Dishonored 2 and Deathloop." Next came The Crossing, a single-player shooter with a multiplayer twist. As the player progressed through the campaign, enemy NPCs could be possessed by real players, who would work together to stop the hero. The asymmetrical PvP experience was a tough sell. Only one publisher was interested, and what they really wanted was a different game on a smaller budget. Colantonio described the deal as a, quote, kiss of death. Even so, Colantonio says he would have accepted the offer to save Arkane. Fortunately, he didn't have to. In 2009, just days before closing the deal, Arkane got a call from Doug Church at EA Games. Church invited Arkane to co-develop LMNO, a project being overseen by Steven Spielberg. It was a first-person action-adventure that revolved around protecting an alien escapee from a government facility. Mitton explained that LMNO needed creators who were versed in, quote, first-person combat, good level design, an RPG layer based on puzzle games, so Arkane was perfect for that. Meanwhile, Arkane had been paying the bills with work-for-hire projects. Later in 2009, while celebrating the closure of a new deal, Colantonio got another fateful call from Doug Church. And it was just like that. LMNO was canceled. The economic turmoil of 2009 made it extra difficult for Arkane to find publishing deals, so after completing some work-for-hire on Bioshock 2, Colantonio made a statement. We're available. Their call was answered by Todd Vaughn of Bethesda Games, who pitched an action-adventure set in feudal Japan. And by 2010, the work-for-hire situation had evolved into a full-blown acquisition by Bethesda's parent company, ZeniMax Media. Arkane eventually traded the project's original setting for an alternate history England, but they kept the name, Dishonored. With Bethesda's support, Arkane devoted both their offices, Lyon and Austin, to the project. Dishonored was directed by Colantonio and Harvey Smith, lead designer of the original Deus Ex. To bring the game to life, Arkane deployed every trick in the immersive sim book. Smith explained his vision for the game, quote, "So when people play Dishonored and they figure out something that they wouldn't have expected to be able to do in the game, that is a magic moment for us." It was a magic moment for gamers as well. Dishonored released in 2012 to critical acclaim and fantastic sales. It won numerous awards, including BAFTA's Game of the Year in 2013. When Dishonored was in playtesting, the buzz was so strong that Arkane started thinking about a sequel. Smith told Game Informer, quote, "We kind of knew before the game came out that we had something." The success of Dishonored also allowed Colantonio to double down on the vision that inspired him to launch Arkane Studios. He described his next game, Prey, as, quote, "the game we wanted to make, which is a little bit like Arx Vitalis." Seeing how the Dishonored community responded to the young Emily Caldwin, Arkane decided to make her story the centerpiece for the sequel. This meant fast-forwarding 15 years and introducing a new threat to her rule. Smith says that the team wanted Dishonored 2 to be, quote, "bigger, richer, deeper. We wanted to see some other places besides Dunwall, but then come back to Dunwall. So we did all that, even though it was a Herculean effort." Dishonored 2 was another critical smash for Arkane. It won PC Gamer's 2016 Game of the Year, along with more than 100 Best of 2016 awards. While Smith was working on Dishonored 2 in Lyon, Colantonio was rebooting Prey in Austin. The game would be Arkane's reimagining of the IP, keeping only the concept of being trapped on a space station with hostile aliens. It was the perfect vehicle for emerging gameplay, player agency, and exploration. Quote, "When I started Arkane," Colantonio explained, "it was very, very important for me that I would bring back those values." Prey would also incorporate modern genre trappings. In 2016, Colantonio described Prey to GameSpot as, quote, "a hybrid game where there's narrative mixed with action mixed with a little bit of an RPG layer." Although Prey didn't sell as well as the Dishonored games, critics loved it. US Gamer validated Colantonio's vision, calling Prey, quote, "a wonderful love letter to some older titles that are sorely missed." After the completion of Prey, Colantonio announced that he was stepping down as head of Arkane Studios to, quote, "spend time with my son and reflect on what is important to me and my future." Harvey Smith took the lead at Arkane in Austin, and Romuald Capron now heads the Lyon office. Since leaving Arkane, Colantonio founded Wolfeye Studios. With their upcoming debut, an action RPG called Weird West, Colantonio continues his exploration of immersive sims. In Arkane's next project, Deathloop, players take on the role of Colt, an assassin caught in a time loop. All the Arkane staples are there: emerging gameplay, temporal shenanigans, mimicry, parkour, stealth, and optional PvP woven into the fabric of the campaign. Arkane joined Xbox Game Studios in 2021 as part of Microsoft's acquisition of Bethesda, but Deathloop will remain a timed Sony exclusive. That said, gamers in the Xbox ecosystem can play Deathloop on Windows 10 PC this fall. For 21 years, Arkane's devotion to immersive sims has meant imagining all the ways players might approach their games, then catering to those playstyles. In other words, Arkane is all about putting gamers first, just like Xbox. Since 2018, Xbox Game Studios has been filling out its roster with creators who know how to craft engaging experiences, build immersive worlds, and tell compelling stories. Arkane doesn't just meet those standards, they're constantly redefining them.